We are very happy to have with us here, of course, the publisher, Mr. Anand, but especially happy to have Arundhati Roy, an old friend of the college, if she won't mind me saying that. Although she has come just once before and spoken here, she got a good response from our students, and that was an indication of the type of impact that she has on young people. So Arundhati, we are very happy that you have come back to share with us these ideas that you have. Revolutionary ideas, I hope, because our country does require a revolution in ideas, if not in violence, definitely not there. But we do require to rethink our different stances and to once again make an analysis of what is happening in our society. St. Xavier's College has always been open to new ideas, and we think it is our responsibility, especially with the type of resources that we have here in the middle of the city, to encourage this type of dialogue on ideas that are crucial to our times, to our world, and to our society. We are also very happy to have Professor Suryakant from the TIS, Tata Institute. We are happy that he will also share with us his ideas. A big welcome. So without more ado, I request Mr. Anand to take over and to initiate this discussion. Thank you for coming, and all the best.
Thank you, Father Fraser, and thank you for responding so quickly and enthusiastically about helping us host this event here. Dr. Ambedkar is already here. It's his book, Annihilation of Caste, which is being launched. I know first called Arundhati Roy and Suryakant Waghmore to come onto the stage, because I'm sure all of you here are familiar with Dr. Ambedkar, and many of you here may have read Annihilation of Caste, the 1936 work which was published, self-published by Ambedkar, because the audience for which he wrote it, he wanted to deliver it as a speech, found it unbearable, and they refused to let him come and speak after seeing an advance copy of the book. And it has been nearly 80 years. And what happened was a kind of an early assassination attempt on this book to let it not come out. And the forum that called him was Jarpat Todak Mandal of Lahore. And the Mandal realized that Ambedkar intended to use that platform to not merely to criticize the practice of caste, but to denounce Hinduism itself. But soon it was translated into 6 languages. Gandhi found fault with the pricing of it. He said it's 8 anas, it should be 4 anas or 2 anas. That was the beginning of his response. But Ambedkar's Annihilation of Caste has survived today because it has been printed and reprinted, like most of Ambedkar's large oeuvre, by small, mostly Dalit-owned presses and read by mostly Dalit readers over 7 decades now. It has now the curious distinction of being one of the most obscure as well as the most widely read books in India. This in itself illuminates the iron grip of the caste system. But Ambedkar intended this speech for a privileged caste audience, an audience that has eluded it over the decades, or an audience which has recently, I met a civil service aspirant at a Delhi lunch, and I asked him, he asked me, what is this that you have published recently? It's a book by Ambedkar. So is it the Constitution of India? So that is the level of, I mean, couldn't think that it would be a book other than the Constitution of India. He didn't know that there was something called the Annihilation of Caste. He's attempting a civil service exam for the second time. He has cleared mains. So it is to redress this that Ambedkar's books are still not available in regular bookshops. They are available in government presses, and it's a very big challenge to go find Ambedkar's writing. So when I read this, and I also ended up annotating this over the last 7 to 10 years, for instance, there were several things there which popped like questions in my mind. Who is this Jarpat Torak Mandal? Who is Santaram who invited him? What happened to Santaram? I realized that he died at the age of 101, just 2 kilometers from where I work from in Delhi. Then I found his autobiography, then it led to a whole thing about who he was and where did he come from and why he was a partition refugee in Delhi and why he died there. And I found that there was no scholarship or pamphlet writing which could illuminate me about these questions. And there were some more than a dozen Sanskrit couplets that Ambedkar throws with authority at his privileged caste audience, and they've never been decoded, deciphered, where did he use them from. And dr.b.r.ambedkar, Roy, the scholar of Sanskrit, he helped us kind of unpack these couplets. And there's several things that Ambedkar says which I couldn't find in books. What is the connection between the communal award and the Roman comitia centuriata? What is the comparison he keeps drawing between caste Hindus and Dalits as between plebeians and patricians? Where does he get these ideas from? What is social endosmosis? Where is he drawing this idea from? What is the C3 people? So all these were attempts, and then this book was heavily reviewed, and at that stage is when I turned to Arundhati Roy, meaning this was 8 to 10 years ago, and then I gave her the annotated version about a year ago, and then this book has been her introduction, which is The Doctor and the Saint. It tries to familiarize reader not just with Ambedkar, but with how caste plays out in contemporary India, and the historical context of the debate between Ambedkar and Gandhi that followed the publication of Annihilation of Caste. Like 2 days ago, Gopal Guru was saying there are two figures whom you have to keep talking about in modern India to understand modern India. That's Gandhi and Ambedkar. This was at the recent 5th annual lecture of the Ambedkar University, Delhi, where Upen Bakshi was speaking and Gopal was responding. In an introduction, Gandhi Roy describes how about a little known side of Gandhi. She shows how his disturbing views on race preceded his views on caste. I mean, his views on race when he was for nearly 20 years in South Africa. She says Ambedkar was Gandhi's most formidable adversary. He challenged him not just politically or intellectually, but also morally. So I'm very happy that Suryakant Waghmore has agreed to respond, and I must say that he agreed to graciously step into the place with Ramesh Kamble was to do. Due to ill health, he could not. He informed us about only 4 or 5 days ago. And I'm sorry, Suryakant didn't have so much time to spend on the book as he would have liked to. It just reached him about 3 days or 2.5 days ago. And Suryakant has written this book, which is, I managed to get it recently myself, and so did Arundhati, Civility Against Caste. And there's one thing which is there in Thomas Blom Hansen, who endorsed this book and was written an endorsement for this book as well, where he talks about Waghmore argues, he says, against this, Dalits insist that classical norms of civility, tolerance and equality be respected. So it is this discourse of civility that Ambedkar was talking about. And we hope any conversation on this book, any dialogue happening across the world, social media, anywhere, respects this civility, because it is the tradition to which we all belong. It is the tradition which Ambedkar will lead to us. Thank you. Now I'll ask, the plan for the evening is that Arundhati will speak for about 20 minutes and mostly from the book, and Suryakant will respond for about 10 to 15 minutes, and then there will be a conversation, then we will take questions. Thank you. Over to Arundhati now.
Thank you all for coming. It's always a difficult job to know how to speak about Ambedkar in India, because it always depends on the audience. You know, there are audiences who know nothing, and then there are audiences who know everything. And that just tells us what sort of a society we live in. What sort of intellectual, social and moral barriers there are between us as a people. You know, ever since I wrote The God of Small Things, which as a novel obviously deals with the society that it was written about, for many years I've been writing political essays, most of them directed at the state and about state policy. But here again, I come back to the tyranny of our society. You know, we don't have any state to blame for this. We actually have a constitution that, in the case of caste, is more enlightened than the society that we live in. So when I started researching and reading about Dr. Ambedkar, basically Annihilation of Caste is this text of a speech that was never delivered. And the person who responded to him was Mahatma Gandhi. And there was a debate between the two of them. They were very hostile towards each other, and yet neither asked the others for the other's work to be banned or for the other to be put away in jail. You know, I mean, imagine, we talk so much these days about the freedom of speech, and we think we are a free people, but if you read what Mirza Ghalib could write about his relationship with his faith in the 19th century, if you read what Manto could write about Maulanas and Mullahs, if you read what Ambedkar could say about Hinduism, what Nehru could say about Kashmir, we aren't that free now. We are less free than they were. We are less free to say profound and difficult things. Our intellectual space has shrunk, and sadly we think it has expanded because we have these laws and so on, but it has shrunk. And you know, if you have a dictatorship like you had in the Soviet Union, and Stalin was, you know, putting people in jail for writing the poems they wrote or saying the things they said, then you had a very beautiful society with poets like Anna Akhmatova and Mandelstam. But now we are censoring ourselves as a people. It's not the state that is censoring us. We are censoring ourselves as a people, and this is a very sad and dangerous thing. But coming back to the Annihilation of Caste, so I started to write the introduction, and reading Ambedkar took me back to reading Gandhi. And I must say that I couldn't believe the things I was reading. I simply couldn't believe it, you know. And what there is in this introduction is not my interpretation, is not analysis that I have come out with. It is basically a presentation from the basic and primary source, which is the collected works of Mahatma Gandhi, the writings and speeches of Ambedkar. But these are, I've tried to, as far as possible, keep myself out of it and just present them in their own words. But since we're going to discuss it, I'm going to just read a couple of sections from the introduction so that you get an idea, even if not an overall view, because obviously you'll have to read the book for that. So, I'm sorry for making this assumption, maybe I'm wrong, but I am going to assume that this is an audience which isn't that familiar with the debates around caste that have been going on. But I'm just going to read a few pages from the beginning of my introduction. Annihilation of Caste is the nearly 80-year-old text of a speech that was never delivered. When I first read it, I felt as though somebody had walked into a dim room and opened the windows. Reading Dr. Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar bridges the gap between what most Indians are schooled to believe in and the reality we experience every day of our lives. My father was a Hindu, a Brahmo. I never met him until I was an adult. I grew up with my mother in a Syrian Christian family in Ayamanam, a small village in communist-ruled Kerala. And yet all around me were the fissures and cracks of caste. Ivanhoe had its own Paren church where Paren priests preached to an untouchable congregation. Caste was implied in people's names, in the way people referred to each other, in the work they did, in the clothes they wore, in the marriages that were arranged, in the language we spoke. Even so, I never encountered the notion of caste in a single school textbook. Reading Ambedkar alerted me to a gaping hole in our pedagogical universe. Reading him also made it clear why that hole exists and why it will continue to exist until Indian society undergoes radical revolutionary change. Revolutions can and often have begun with reading. If you have heard of Malala Yousafzai, but not of Surekha Ghotmange, then do read Ambedkar. Malala was only 15 but had already committed several crimes. She was a girl, she lived in the Swat Valley in Pakistan, she was a BBC blogger, she was in a New York Times video, and she went to school. Malala wanted to be a doctor, her father wanted to be a politician, her to be a politician. She was a brave child, and she and her father didn't take heed when the Taliban declared that schools were not meant for girls and threatened to kill her if she didn't stop speaking out against them. In October 2012, a gunman took her off a school bus and put a bullet through her head. Malala was flown to England, where after receiving the best possible medical care, she survived. It was a miracle. The US President and Secretary of State sent messages of support and solidarity. Madonna dedicated a song to her. Malala was nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize. And Gordon Brown, the former British Prime Minister, launched an I Am Malala petition that called on the government of Pakistan to deliver education to every girl child. Surekha Ghotmange was 40 years old and had committed several crimes too. She was a woman, an untouchable Dalit woman who lived in India, and she wasn't dirt poor. She was more educated than her husband, and so she functioned as the head of her family. Dr. Ambedkar was her hero. Like him, her family had renounced Hinduism and converted to Buddhism. Surekha's children were educated. Her two sons, Sudhir and Roshan, had been to college. Her daughter Priyanka was 17 and finishing high school. Surekha and her husband had bought a little plot of land in the village of Khairlanji in Maharashtra. It was surrounded by farms belonging to castes that considered themselves superior to the Mahar caste that Surekha belonged to. Because she was a Dalit and had no right to aspire to a good life, the village panchayat did not permit her to get an electricity connection or to turn her thatched mud hut into a brick house. The villagers would not allow her family to irrigate their fields with water from the canal or draw water from the public well. And they tried to build a public road through her land, and when she protested, they drove their bull carts through her fields and let the cattle loose to feed on her standing crop. So Surekha complains to the police. The police will not listen to her. Then the villagers begin to beat up her relatives and so on. And eventually, the police actually do come and arrest a few people and release them the same day. And that same day, this mob from the village of Khairlanji arrived in Surekha Ghotmange's house, and they basically pulled out Surekha and Priyanka, her daughter, and her two sons. They ordered the boys to rape their mother. When they refused, they lynched them. And then they lynched and killed Surekha Ghotmange and her daughter and her two sons, and their bodies were found floating in a canal. This news, of course, is reported in very minor ways in the press, and that too is suggested that it's some moral crime that they committed. Surekha Ghotmange and her children lived in a market-friendly democracy, so there were no I Am Surekha petitions from the United Nations to the Indian government, nor any fiats or messages of outrage from heads of state, which was just as well, because we don't want daisy cutters dropped on us because we practice caste. To the untouchables, Ambedkar said, with the sort of nerves that present-day intellectuals in India find hard to summon up. And I'm quoting Dr. Ambedkar here, to the untouchables, Hinduism is a veritable chamber of horrors, unquote. According to the National Crime Records Bureau, a crime is committed against a Dalit by a non-Dalit every 16 minutes, every day. More than 4 untouchable women are raped by touchables. 13 Dalits are murdered and 6 Dalits are kidnapped. In 2012 alone, all of us remember the protests against the Delhi gang rape and murder victim. That year, 1,500 Dalit women were raped by upper caste men. And that's only the reported rapes. The thumb rule is 1 in 10 are reported, so we are talking about something like 15,000. In 1919, at the height of the movement, the lynchings of black people in the United States, at the height of it, when it was known as the Red Summer, 165 black people were lynched. But in 2012 alone, 651 Dalits were killed in India. If the fundamental rights are opposed, I'm quoting Ambedkar here, if the fundamental rights are opposed by the community, no law, no parliament, no judiciary can guarantee them in the real sense of the word, said Ambedkar. What is the use of fundamental rights to the Negro in America, to the Jews in Germany, and to the untouchables in India? There is no method found for punishing the multitude. Ask any village policeman in India what his job is, and he'll probably tell you it's to keep the peace. That is done most of the time by upholding the caste system. Dalit aspirations are a breach of peace. Annihilation of caste is a breach of peace. So this is just the beginning, you know, then, I mean, the introduction to it goes back to place Ambedkar in the tradition of anti-caste intellectuals who started, of course, with the Buddhists and went through the Bhakti saints and so on. And then Gandhi arrives and basically says that caste is a great thing. It is the genius of Hindu civilization. And he comes from a long tradition of Hindu reformers who, by the turn of the century, are preaching to untouchables, as they were called in those days, because suddenly, you know, governance had changed from the idea of empire to the idea of the nation. And there was this whole thing about representation, and there was a whole anxiety about demography. And suddenly, this whole thing we know as Hindutva, which has nothing to do with religion and everything to do with politics, started then. And the idea was to woo Dalits back into the Hindu fold, but keep them in the basement, you know, keep them in the servants' quarters. And this marked the beginning of a whole new era in the politics of caste in India. But I think we can talk now about it. Yeah? Okay.
Thank you, Anand, for having me here. It's really a pleasure to get to read this book ahead of time and get it free. So, under the mind getting staying up at night and reading it. So, though it was last minute, I enjoyed reading it. What I've done is I have kind of listed my notes, so I'll read through. As I said, I enjoyed reading it, and Arundhati writes so well that you always think that you can improve your writing the way you write when you read them. So that was the first thing that comes to your mind when you are reading it. So about the book and the introduction to it that Arundhati writes, which is a very detailed one and a very exciting one to read. So this book is timely. Actually, it has arrived late, but any change around caste takes rather too long in our great Indian civilization.
So this is a welcome addition around Ambedkar and Annihilation of Caste. I prefer to call Annihilation of Caste as the only modern seminal text produced by a highly educated and scholarly Hindu in colonial India. So that's the central idea. Anything radical came up in colonial India, which questions the fundamentals of the morals which are problematic in Indian society, it is Annihilation of Caste. And ignoring it is at the peril of Hindus, as Ambedkar himself has pointed out what his attempt was. I think this is a first where a famous, but not mainstream, even the fact that you also have sedition charge against you, you are not definitely famous or popular. So, a famous author of Indian descent has taken some time to think on the moral corruption of caste that governs the Indian conscience, Mahatma included. And for a change, the path taken is Ambedkar. The power of annihilation of caste is not new for Dalits. The reverence that caste Hindus might have for Bhagavad Gita, though contrary, Ambedkar and Dalits carry a similar devotion for annihilation of caste. However, the normality of caste purity that constructs the life worlds of the privileged Hindus, Muslims, Christians, as privileged caste Hindus, Muslims, Christians, makes the idea of annihilation abnormal and a Dalit burden. So that's the problem we are facing in Dalit times. There is a talk about this book, there is a talk amongst few Dalits therefore, on whether Arundhati and Anand should indulge in this exercise at all. I fear that by doing this, we will be throwing both the privileged caste and their suppressed humanism out of Ambedkarite praxis. Though long driven, caste sickness can be cured and we should not lose hope. On a lighter note, but technically sound in a Hindu way, I think Arundhati is not a pure caste. Born out of miscegenation to a Brahmo and a Syrian Christian woman, she cannot be. Such sexual mess-ups theoretically result in birth of chandalas and touchables. So there's very little need for her to run for cover. This of course leaves out Anand. To those who are well-versed with any South Indian village, Anand may seem like a restless priest of a small village temple. But I call him the greatest Brahmin betrayal of this century. He is an outcast for most of the traditional and modern Brahmins who might have read him. I have arrived at this through reading the comments for all that Anand has written so far. He may well be the most abused Brahmin of present times online. And given the fact that the pace at which Dalit political leaders who get trained in Ambedkarism and leave Ambedkarite politics to join BJP, present examples are Udit Raj, Athole, Ram Vilas Paswan. Outcast privileged castes are welcome. I mean, these are exceptions. We better take them in instead of sending them out. However, without investing much time on this issue, I will go on to Arundhati's introduction to annihilation of caste. I'll call it AOC here onwards. This introduction is a brilliant introductory text for those Indians who have not read Ambedkar for caste reasons. I mean that your caste has obstructed it from reading. You obstructed you from reading Ambedkar. So this is a very brilliant text for introduction. Like Arundhati writes in the introduction, and Ambedkar insisted long back in Annihilation of Caste, caste ideology and practice is a sign of intolerance, inequality and social hierarchy. Why then does caste continue to thrive as a socio-political, ritual and economic practice? The answers are there in AOC and also in Arundhati's essay. Arundhati has tried to historicize and contemporize AOC. I think the fundamentals lay in the popular understanding of caste not being a disease, not even parts of it. It is rather a moral practice. Caste, no doubt, makes India's democracy both vibrant and indigenous. So what I have done is I have tried to, just briefly, I'll talk about the history bits of the book. I am not going to go in details. And the present, because as a sociologist, I am more concerned about the present, so maybe I'll just briefly engage with that. Arundhati does well to point out the moral control of caste on the privileged, and Ambedkar's struggle to liberate the untouchables, and the tyranny of the privileged from caste, ignorance, and arrogance. That is, the privileged themselves are kind of victimized because of this ignorance and arrogance. Gandhi serves a critical case to help us better understand the problems with Hindu morality. In an international context, given that the borders are blurred, transition or movement from between states is very common for privileged Hindus, I think interrogating Gandhi both in and outside India, South Africa, is very important, because that kind of sets tone for understanding what happens to caste privilege when it moves around the world. So you have elements of getting at the fundamentals here very much. So Gandhi serves as a critical case to help us better understand the problems with Hindu morality. His politics, morals, experiments, and the movement from truth to truth. I think that is, the book is laced with sarcasm, so you just have to read and enjoy it in Gandhi. So this movement from truth to truth, despite modern education, was less puzzling and more disturbing for Ambedkar. Because through AOC, Ambedkar kind of opens this up for interrogation. So he's bringing the fundamentals and the actual workings of caste. So he's not puzzled, so he's just by Gandhi's behavior. The details of South African experience, therefore, does well to expose the cunning nature of Gandhi's politics. I will not go into the details, but it has very interesting elements of how Gandhi moves in between various political positions to differentiate Indians as a race who are closer to the British whites and who are much higher than the Kafirs and the local blacks there. Gandhi's views on race presaged his views on caste, you suggest. I thought this could also be other way around. Maybe you would like to throw some light on this when we talk. I thought also the present times could have been covered better. And Ambedkar is a very, though you said it very well, the way Ambedkar has been ignored. So to move on, Arundhati writes, "Devolution comes through reading." Gandhi is the best example of how this idea does not work in India. We read but do not understand. We listen but do not follow. We see but it does not affect us. That is the, and this is to do with the morality of caste. You know, that's how it is, and that's what Ambedkar is engaging with in AOC. It takes an Amir Khan to get us to see a TV serial on social issues. See. And an Arundhati to sell Ambedkar. Sell in a good way. Everything has to be sold. You know, we buy pens, we buy papers. So if you have to sell Ambedkar, it's all that. Money is not always. This is most important. There are some real good parts on violence against Dalits, real good parts on how the present capitalist organization of India can actually be well disaggregated on basis of caste. Interesting figures also you make a minor criticism from some economists because they engage in figures better than all of us. Because you cite Pushpan Singh somewhere, so maybe. Of course, you say there is no data on how these aspects, but maybe authentic sources is anyway, people will, scholars will point that out. I appreciate the passion throughout. The present picture is, however, I thought throughout, though Gandhi is critical and very important to understand, the present, I don't know why this is running away from me. It's all on. Okay. I thought the present picture would have been more nuanced. For instance, violence against Dalits is a very important aspect to talk of the violence of caste. But the violence of caste, how it percolates into violence against women in privileged castes. So this is a very understudied subject, especially amongst the dominant castes. And that comes all those Marathas, Jats, and so on and so forth. So violence against caste Hindu women in rural areas is something that is well hidden, not documented, and not reported. And that, I think, is more troubling than, because Dalits are fighting, privileged caste women cannot fight, and the gender elements could have been more engaging. Despite enjoying it so much, there are some elements which I'm talking about your essay and. In the discussion on AOC, you can link this when we respond on how it's linked to AOC. But I thought at times there is this presentation of present picture as very bleak, very troubling. The possibilities are of change are less. So, for instance, though the violence is there against Dalits, the rate of conviction in SCST Atrocity Act was much higher and better in UP when Mayawati was in power. So, this possibilities of turning it around, where are they and how people are engaging, could have been brought out much better at all. So, democracy is working in certain forms that could have been out there. It works for minors when they claim and assert. You kind of reconstruct Varna in absolute terms for present times. Brahmins control bureaucracy, media, along with Baniya owners. Baniyas do capital or capitalism. Shudras control the lower floor of this whole building and keep everyone out. This can be problematic. I mean, the critique of Brahminism is important and it's very much part of the society. But this kind of becomes anti-Brahmin, anti-Baniya. What you mentioned in passing, that there are some dominant castes who are broken into control of media, but that's in passing. You know, and that, because what I feel is, if you look at the rural economy, the peasant capitalists are really dominant and they decide on how both the upper and the lower caste will function and how caste will work in the rural spaces. There's also a little distinction about, it could have been mentioned again in passing, that cities and villages, caste is different. You know, in cities, there is at least this invisibility attached to your identity. So, but in villages, it's absolute. There is no scope for maneuvering. Therefore, the conflict is quite upfront, which is not in cities. In cities, it's complex. Maybe if you would have linked this to AOC, because Ambedkar kind of brings out the fundamental moral problems with the text and how you end up ingrained and practice this text of all these scriptures and practice of caste. So if this could have brought out in the context of cities, there is enough material. If you just look at this Marathi newspaper, the way they write in very polite Marathi that SCSTs are not in matrimonials, you know, except SCST, everyone is fine. So these are the practices. How the modern Hindu can also be this, you know, that's the problem. So in present times, most violence against Dalits is carried out by dominant warrior castes. In my own study, I found that 45% of the violent cases of violence against Dalits were done by Kunbi Marathas. Now this is a huge number of cases. I mean, if one was to follow a colonial notion of allotting criminal status to castes and tribes, some castes can be declared as criminal, you know, because of this continuous engagement in violence. So Marathas, Kunbis in Maharashtra, Jats in Haryana, Gondar, Thevar, Vanir, Reddy, Kama, Vakaliga, Lingayat, Patel, Yadav, Ranveer, now this points to a new dynamics of power. The fact that Modi is a Teli, the language is anti-caste, but radically Hindu also. So this is very new and very working. So maybe this could be explained when we discuss. So we are in a difficult situation of dominant caste practicing Brahminism radically, a gruesome combination of atrocious patriarchy locally within their households, coupled with violent social distance with Dalits and other non-pure castes. I have never worked in an NGO, though TSS generally gets attached, Tata Institute, they say. But I also thought that, though you mentioned that NGOs may help Dalits in certain way, mobility and all, I think you all only brought this scholar called, I must tell you all that, you know, this is a very scholarly set of writing that Arundhati has done. So this is not just general ranting that activists do. So she's based it on exhaustive references and all. But in this case, I thought you quote only Anand Telgunde. So he just feeds into your case. So there are others, including me, who have argued against, given a nuanced picture, maybe that could better. You do a good job, and I think this is where I can be in trouble. You do a very good job exposing Ambedkar's problematic attribution of primitivity to tribes and obvious problems with it. But the appreciation of Maoist is kind of blind to the caste question there. Those who fight within these struggles are tribes, and those who lead are not. I am also not sure if we can homogenize all Adivasis and their aspirations as one linked to forest and protection of forests. When most forests have been grabbed in present times, and mode of violence, I am no Gandhian, but this engagement with paying through gun to the state and those involved, because state is also very amorphous and various groups have stakes in the state, including the Adivasis. So against this violence of this scale, are democratic means possible? What do you think of tribal political leaders in central India? Are any of them good enough to make democracy work for them? I also felt that some space, see, the introduction is important. Annihilation of caste is there, and it's Anand does a very good job of providing annotations and details to them. I mean, one should not run away from the fact that Anand is doing a very, and Arundhati are engaged in getting a text out which generally would not be read by privileged castes, and also has a lot of details about Gandhi, as I said, who serves a critical case to expose the elements of this problems with this morality. So it's very much there. So I'm not really going to talk about AOC, as I said, but it's very essential. Therefore, you bring in Gandhi. But I thought some space could have been also in passing for Gandhi could have been reduced somewhere, and you could have also engaged with the repulsion of Hindus to Muslims, and I think this is linked to caste morality, you know, in present times. So, and because even Ambedkar points out to this while writing about the Hindu-Muslim relation and how Hindus react to Muslims. Finally, two suggestions. I am no one to suggest much to you, but generally, as a Dalit who has spent considerable time in village, the first paper I wrote in EPW. I don't know why, how I ended up with poor editors. They edited it again, they did a very poor job, the EPW. But it was about what I faced in the village and how I dealt with it and so on. So there may be some passion in what I'm saying. But, so not sure how much it will sell, but I think for Anand, it is important to make vernacular edition of the whole book possible. Yeah. Marathi, Hindi is there, yeah, that would be very great. Arundhati, I know you like to travel light. Once you are done with annihilation of castes, you may move on to writing something new and as political. You know, and you have made substantial contributions to general people's thinking. Whereas Dalits will continue to bear, take that burden of AOC further. It's part of our lives. We have to do it. I have a suggestion as you move on, if you move on. You might want to change your Brahmo surname that you got from your Brahmin father. You may want to convert to Ambedkar's Buddhism. Notional. But just notional. Do it. It's merely about principles, as you write in the text. And finally, join some Dalit political party. Any that you think is non-corrupt and promises change in the long run. All your friends, this Mela partner, I think you work with her for a time. She's with AAP now. No. But see, this faith in working on politics, including Anna Hazare, is kind of problematic for me of the caste consciousness. If caste has to work, you have to have a very strong belief in democracy. But if you have to challenge caste, even then you have to have a strong belief in democracy. That's what I derive from Ambedkar. Democracy. Yeah. And workings of party politics. And unfortunately, democracy in India is reduced to the working of party politics. Much change in India is through compulsion, and which is generated through party politics. So this is about the text, the main introduction, which is substantial and very important. The annotations, I mean, one could substantially enjoy them because it gives, as I said, for instance, about Santram, what Anand was mentioning. Now, and who is part of Jatpat Todak Mandal, who calls Ambedkar to give this talk. Very interestingly, he, and Anand mentions it, that he uses his surname as BSC, you know, so. B.A. Sorry. Okay, yes. Santram, I don't know why I've written B.S.C. There are others who use this. Okay. Right. So, and he's not a Brahmin, you know. So, and there are others who change their surnames. I don't know whether some of you may have read this, but there was recently a case in Bihar where a lawyer who is from Ranbir caste sued his son for marrying a Kurmi. And the case was about the son should be dropping the surname Sharma because he is married a lower caste. Now, and our courts function very interestingly. They have admitted that case. I don't understand what kind of logic this is. So the dynamism of modernity and legalism is very interesting. It can accommodate everything in India. So you do well point out several things here in the annotations and the associated struggles to and the problematic context, you know, that I've been facing. I really like, for instance, this note that you mentioned on why not Sikhism. It's generally not part of discourse, but you cite the scholars saying that the Jats were scared that if so many Dalits join Sikhism, the Jats will be of no relevance. So that's very interesting. I think the elements of Dewey's contribution and so on. I thought the parts on eugenics and on the race element, eugenics and how Ambedkar, I thought that page 240, I don't have the text, but what Ambedkar is, I think, trying to say is, because some of the, and this is also in Arundhati's introduction, you know, she engages with some of our great indigenous feminist scholars like Madhu Kishwar, who say that caste is very important in making our society work right now. So I am really glad that you, I would have appreciated you would have, if you would have maybe given one page to demolishing these guys further. But yeah, these guys, these scholars are really troubling us. I don't know what kind of education and what kind of morals they carry. It's troublesome. So I thought what Ambedkar was doing here is also is, if you see, he says if so there is this caste group which is saying, you know, caste is part of having racial purity so that you are martially great. You know, you can be you can prevent that purity to be a certain kind of race. Now he's saying if you think caste is this, then you are not really succeeded in achieving those kind of high. You're just a C3 kind of species. But this is just in passing. Maybe again, as I said, my blind eye being a passionate scholar, we can just talk about it later also. But what I thought was that the annotations are so rich that you know, you enjoy reading the annotation of caste further because of this, because it's a parallel paper with really detailed background of the scholars Ambedkar is influenced with the kind of people who are trying to obstruct or are trying to help Ambedkar and so on. So it makes a very interesting reading. I think it's you need to make this fresh, and that is what the book has done. So because it's very relevant, you know, and you are taking it to a new audience, which is very important. So I think I'll stop here. And
thank you, Suryakant, for what I felt was a very useful response. I mean, we need to think about these issues that you have flagged. And as for Roy dropping us a name, and I mean, this bit about Santaram is very, very interesting. So he's born into a potter caste. One of the things that, because it is for to Santaram also that we owe this text in many ways. So for me, one of the first searches, it took me 6 to 8 months to write that footnote, because this information is not available on Google. You cannot just say who is Santaram and find an answer. It's not in Wikipedia. There's lots of stuff here which you need to kind of meet people, translate texts. My Hindi improved in the whole process of doing this, and Ajay Navarya, my Hindi has improved. Because you have to read original texts, and I had good help with Yuli Petzel doing this. But Santaram drops his caste name and adopts BA, the education. You know, I mean, what Ambedkar is talking about, educate, organize, agitate. I mean, that is symbolized by Santaram and his partners there, some of whom are Bhagwan. And it's so ironic that, because of this surname thing, I'm just speaking a bit about it. Har Bhagwan was an associate of Santaram, who was not as strong-hearted as Santaram was in defending Ambedkar and continuing to correspond with Ambedkar. Ambedkar goes on to write a preface for Santaram's book. This was told to me by Bhagwan Das, and without Bhagwan Das, I wouldn't have really gone as deep into this as I could, because he was an inspiration for me. And Bhagwan Das used to tell me, I mean, in his writing there was so much about those times, because Ambedkar, he was somebody who met Ambedkar, and I could sit with Bhagwan Das and talk about it. That was my pleasure and privilege. So you could find out that this Har Bhagwan was actually a Sethi in 1972. He writes in a journal called The Atheist, which is published from Vijayawada by the Atheist Center. And then they inform us very gently that he's actually a Sethi. Till then, there's no record of the fact that Harbhagwan was a Sethi. So the way the thing comes back, when the atheists want to publish a note by Harbhagwan. So this is there, and another question posed to you was of, can you be an Ambedkarite Maoist? Can you be an Ambedkarite Maoist? Is it important? Because this, for Ambedkar, as she said in the earlier part of her speech, it's a society, and today she was talking about how society is the first curb against free speech, and Dalits have the best experience of this. Dalits have the worst experience of this in some ways, in terms of seeing society as the, and Ambedkar is very, has a very theoretically strong position on how society is the real enemy more than the state. Whereas for the Maoists, it's the other way around. They're not addressing society's inequalities as much as that imposed by the state. So that's as he said, you know, there's so much of it, the Teltumde line. But in Suryakant's response, I found Teltumde's line as well, where he talks with wants us to emphasize more of the middle caste violence on Dalits, which is what Teltumde has been arguing since especially after the 70s Green Revolution. He says this is what has been happening. So over to Roy for her response.
In this hall about this subject before. See, one of the things that I think we should think about is that what has happened to radical politics today, you know, and when you look at movements like the Narmada movement or the Maoist movement or all the militant movements that exist today in Orissa, Jharkhand. I'm not just talking about the Maoists, but the Maoists are the militant end and the Gandhians are the other end and all of that. But think back to the 1960s, at the time when whether it was the Naxalites or whether it was JP or whoever it was, what they were talking about was equality, was land to the tiller. Today, the only thing they're talking about is whatever we have left with us, at least let us keep. And they've been pushed, the radical movements have been pushed to the wall, you know. And so even they are only talking about allowing those who have land to retain the land, which is Adivasi people in the forest, in the mountains. They've all been pushed back. The radical movements are not talking about the landless. And Dalits are predominantly a landless people. So they are left out of that equation altogether. But I think, you know, having been pushed back into the forests from even the plains where they did exist in the 70s and 80s, even the Maoists and earlier communist parties have tried at some point, you know, to do things like seize land and redistribute it, but they've never been. The minute the state kicks in with the kind, with all the violence in its power, you know. So I think one of the problems is that I think Ambedkar faced this problem too in his time, which is that when it comes to caste, where do you pitch your struggle, you know, because after all, whether you take up arms or you don't take up arms, though people, scholars, journalists, all of us like to make it into an ideological debate, I always say it's a strategic one, you know. For example, if you're fighting a dam, the dam is being built there, let's say the Narmada Dam, the dam is being built in Gujarat, you have no access to that site. The water is rising in Madhya Pradesh. If you pick up arms, who are you going to fire at? The river? You know, you can't. Even if you wanted to, you can't. Similarly, if you're in the forest in Chhattisgarh, where I went and spent time, if 1,000 CRP, BSF come and surround your village and start raping the women and burning it, what are you going to do? I mean, no political party or hunger fast or anything is going to help, you know. So I keep talking about the biodiversity of resistance, like we don't get boxed into one kind of way of thinking. I mean, look at Ambedkar, you know, how many times he crossed the line from resistance into power, into back, you know, he was a very nimble mover. He had that kind of brilliant mind that could do it. I mean, everybody on earth has heard about the salt satyagraha. I myself have been one of the people who, though I was never a Gandhian, I used to always say that this was such a brilliant political theatre, piece of political theatre. But 3 years before the salt satyagraha, Ambedkar led the Mahat satyagraha, which nobody in India has heard of, you know, except Dalits, who celebrated every year. But in the Mahat satyagraha, 10,000 Dalits marched through Mahad to the tank to drink water. And when we're talking about the right and the left, Hindu right and Hindu left, you know, V.D. Savarkar supported the Mahad satyagraha, but Gandhi did not. And he wasn't talking exactly about Mahad, but that same month he was saying that when untouchables must get where they want to get by sweet persuasion. But when they do a satyagraha, it's actually a duragraha, you know, which he defined as a devilish force. So, but Ambedkar, though he could have there were two Mahat satyagrahas, the second time around, he could have, you know, stormed the tank again and drunk and forced the Brahmins to give way and they could have drunk the water, but he chose not to because he thought that now this is a social problem. It would be much better if he could be empowered by a law, you know. But yeah, for people in the villages. Now, all this is sort of strategic thinking, which I think we should be careful of locking ourselves into just making them ideologies when they could be strategies, very clever strategies, you know. In the same way, I think, I've always said this, people, maybe the Maoist party has its manifesto and its arguments and, you know, whoever is allowed to say whatever, but people don't play by those rules. You know, people can be Gandhians on the street and Maoists in the forest and whatever they want to be, you know. And this is very important that we don't fall into a grid where you force what works in one political scape or in one landscape into another landscape, you know. I would be flexible about those things. I don't think that anybody can deny the immense work that the BSP has done in building Dalit dignity. At the same time, that doesn't mean that democracy is not so terribly flawed. You know, today we know how flawed it is. It's just been reduced to elections. It's just been reduced to something where everyone's energies get depleted, everyone feels happy, and then you go back. So, I think we should be able to handle many levels of different kinds of politics together, and that can only happen when you don't think like the state. You know, when you think subversively, and I think particularly in caste politics, it's very important to think subversively, you know, like it's important to destabilize and unsettle those boundaries.
Yeah, that makes it interesting because you see this in Ambedkar. He starts with exhaustive engagement with the colonial state. As soon as there is talk of independence and writing the constitution, he realizes. But this is also very interesting. You can say he ceases to be subversive in those times, you know, because the pressure of being a true nationalist is so high that everything has to be strategically worded. So even in the constitution, you cannot use the word religious minorities and so on. So he's troubled. So maybe are you saying that then constitution was just a kind of compromise that Ambedkar made with the elites?
Well, I'm not saying it. He himself, I mean, there's a footnote in my essay where he himself says, I would burn it, you know. I mean, he himself was very disturbed by it. But I think what was very interesting is, as this country hurtled towards independence, I mean, honestly, you know, when you read this book, so many easy ideas, so many default positions get turned over. It's very, very unsettling, you know, so many things. So, anyways, India's hurtling towards independence. Both Ambedkar and Gandhi are worried about what is going to happen to minorities. In Gandhi's case, he's mostly worried about the Muslim minority. In Ambedkar's case, he's worried about what's going to happen to untouchables. And yet, they both have very different reactions, you know. Gandhi starts getting very philosophical and he says, you know, I don't believe in the country and it's in the moral will of the people and so on. For Ambedkar, this category of the people is a very troubling one, you know, because he knows that the people will eventually come to mean the privileged caste Hindu majority. So he's, you know, even though he has spent so many years baiting the Congress, he actually desperately wants to maneuver himself into a position where he can be on the committee that writes the constitution, so that he can put in these safeguards which he's been working on since the 1920s, you know, which he's presented at the round table and so on. And how he gets on to it is an interesting story in itself, you know, because though Ambedkar was such a brilliant mind, but Gandhi was a more brilliant politician. He was able to maneuver things in ways where you know, he, even by the late 40s, when the Muslim Hindu identity became more important than the untouchable and privileged caste identity, all these things were going on at a breakneck speed. So how Ambedkar came to be on the drafting committee, being nominated by the Muslim League from Bengal through the Scheduled Caste Federation, and then Bengal gets partitioned, so again he loses his place, then Nehru nominates him. And it's really a very fascinating story, because in India you had Ambedkar, who became the first law minister, and in Pakistan you had Jyotirinath Mandal, who became the first law minister, also a Dalit, and how they both became so disillusioned with things, you know. So the whole story is very, very fascinating, and I would love to talk about just the just the process of the idea of writing, you know, because unlike Anand or unlike Suryakant, I'm a writer who, meaning you're scholars and noters and all of that, but for me, the telling of the story was important. You know, how do you tell it? Like, I want to send this book to, when Richard Attenborough made Gandhi, the film, which won 8 Oscars, and which is the version of the independence struggle that the whole world knows. Ambedkar didn't even have a walk-on part, you know? So, a couple of years ago, I was in England for something, and I was sitting somewhere, and Ben Kingsley, who played Gandhi, came in and, for some reason, you know, went down on his knees and kissed my hand. I said, are you sure you're, like, not mistaking me for someone else? Like, I don't know why he's doing. No. So I want to send him this book and say, I want you to play Gandhi again in this film. You know? And it'll be more fun. It'll be more fun. You know? But how do you tell? story? How do you tell a story? How do you tell people who don't want to hear the story? How do you make them listen to the story? For me, these are also very, very important things. You know, it's not just that. Let's get a famous writer to write an introduction, no? But the famous writer is also famous for a reason. Didn't get born famous, you know? So the art of telling these stories is what is going to change the way people look at other people, you know? It's such a deep-rooted and sickening thing that it's not, the system of caste is not just that it has made victims of the subordinate castes. It has made victims of us all. It has made victims all of us. We are sick people until we deal with this. Like Ambedkar said, we're sick people, you know, and we have to get this out of our blood. We can't be anywhere. There is nowhere in the world that is as grotesque as this, because I mean, not even apartheid, you know, not even apartheid was as horrible as what we practice today all the time, even though we try to invisibilize it.
This whole thing about annihilation of caste, when I started reading it and in terms of looking for scholarship around it, and you would start reading Hind Swaraj, which is considered Gandhi's most important contribution to literature, translated from Gujarati, and scores of papers, not just on that, but Gandhi, and you know, it's like a whole cottage industry around it, every year at least 10 books. And on the word, the use of the word Vaishya, Ajay Skharia writes a 10-page special article in EPW. I mean, he's entitled to write it, there should be scholarship of that kind. But if you just want to know, Vaishya, as in prostitute, because Ambedkar calls the British Parliament a sterile prostitute. So these are the kind of views which even upset Sarojini Naidu, but he refused to take it back. It continues to be printed like that. Yes, it was a banned book at one time, and then the ban was revoked only in 1935, from 1909, immediately it was banned, and then later they lifted the ban, the British government. But you know, you have such deep studies of this, engaged studies with every word, everything, like she says, you know, everything has been parsed. And with Ambedkar, you have absolutely, I mean, I want to ask Suryakant,
what you're saying, the interesting thing about it is that you have such deep studies and so many biographies, and yet
none that
total cover up. I mean, sorry to interrupt you, but I just want to say two things. Like, I spent a lot of time in South Africa, and you know, all of you have read the story. All of us have been taught the story of how did Gandhi get his first political awakening? Because he was thrown out of a whites-only train compartment in Pietermaritzburg. This is half the story. The other half is that Gandhi was sitting in the whites-only compartment because he believed that Indians, upper caste, privileged caste Indians, were of the Indo-Aryan extraction and should not be sitting with the Kafirs. That the black people should be separated and Indians should be separated. The first political victory he won in South Africa was to get a third entrance opened to the Durban post office so that Indians would not have to use the same entrance as black people. And after that, you know, for the next 20 years, all of it is here, so I'm not going to talk about it. All of it, quoting him, quoting his letters and his articles, things about looking forward to an imperial brotherhood with the British in Africa, fighting on the side of the British in the Boer War, fighting on the side of the British and the Zulu uprising, when land was being taken from the Zulus and people were being beheaded and disseminated, you know, decimated. And even Churchill was saying, you know, this kind of savagery is unacceptable. So you're right that in a way you could say that his views on caste presaged his views. views on race. But actually, see, Gandhi grew up in Baroda, he hadn't been to the villages, and he went, of course, you know, he came from this Baniya family, and they must have had, he did. But, you know, before he, like, for example, he experimented with eating beef and crossing the Kala Pani and all of that. But the articulation began with the articulation on race, you know, on the articulation of what was going on with race. And it's really.
Yes. This obsession with purity and distance.
That was caste.
Kind of, yeah. Yes. So there is a mix of these.
So it was, I've written about that too, you know, the fact that how did this concept of satyagraha begin? And, it began at a time when he was constantly proposing a collaboration with the white regime, you know. And he writes quite openly about the fact that the business passenger class, business Indians, are from the Indo-Aryan stock. But then he writes openly about how indentured labor, whether they are Hindus or Muslims, are devoid of any moral faculties and they are inherent liars. And of course, later on, I'm starting, you know, this from 1893 when he first arrives in South Africa, and you follow what the things he writes right up to 1946. But when in 1936, Ambedkar writes this brilliant, brilliant Annihilation of Caste, that same year, Gandhi wrote an essay too. It was called The Ideal Bhangi. And it's in this book, you have to read it to believe it. You know, he believed that everybody should follow their ancestral calling. And what should an ideal bhangi be like? How he should know to examine urine and night soil and to tell the person in advance that, oh, you know, your stomach is not well or whatever it is, you know? And how he should always do this as a divine calling and never think to amass wealth out of it. It's quoted here. And 7 years later, in his book, which he subsequently withdrew, Karam Yogi, Modi said the same thing about Gandhiji. The quote is here, about it being a divine calling, and this is why they're chosen, this is what they have been chosen, divinely chosen to do. So, a lot of Ambedkar's point about there not being that much difference between what we think of as the Hindu right and the liberals is borne out in so many ways, you know, there are people who are sort of possessive and claiming annihilation of caste as theirs, you know, certain sections of Dalits, but actually it was written for a privileged caste audience to educate them.
I mean, to go back to that thing of why is there, see, especially after 1991, the Ambedkar centenary, you have a lot of interest in it, and scholars also start doing this tokenism of saying, like she talks in her essay, about how people will say, who's the best, they'll start doing surveys and, you know, you'll find it in the top five, top, and this has started. But still, in terms of sheer scholarly engagement, I mean, you have an odd Christoph of Jeffrey Law writing a biography, and there's some scholarship happening in India, but in terms of looking at, say, the Annihilation of Caste or the Buddhism, or hundreds of essays and his unpublished writings. Most of his, 70% of his writings are posthumously published. Many times he doesn't have the money to print the kind of his, several of them were published by Thacker and Co. here. And several times Ambedkar didn't have the resources to publish as much as the funded empire that Gandhi ran. So despite that, now we don't find so much scholarship. What do you think, Suryakant, is the reason?
What I was thinking was this, as I said, this is a brilliant attempt, but there has been work around Ambedkar, and there is exhaustive material on that. It's very important that we focus on Annihilation of Caste. What I want to say is, this is a very brilliant introduction that you write, and you are the best person to take it across to an audience which hasn't read. It's meant for privileged caste, as you said. But this should just be the beginning of something which has to be much more exhaustive, because as I said, that the caste travels in multiple spaces at a very enlightening speed, and affects us at various spheres. So, and that would require exhaustive kind of work, which is there. I thought what is the brilliant part of this book is your obsession with Gandhi. You know, and it is good. Why it is good is because it kind of dismantles what kind of ideals we celebrate. You know, and you write passing.
He stands in the way of understanding Ambedkar. I mean, since we are here in Bombay, I just want to say one more thing, which is another part of the book. I mean, on the introduction as well as Annihilation of Caste, a brilliant part in the Annihilation of Caste is the Ambedkar's conversation with communists and with socialists. And on the back of the book, there's this wonderful quote where he says the caste system is not merely a division of labor. It is also a division of laborers. So, you know, in 1927 was that the great Mahat Satyagraha, and in 1925 was when the Communist Party of India was first formed. And Dange was one of the great Brahmin trade union leaders. He led the Gini Kangar union strike. Now, a large number of those workers were Mahars, the same caste that Ambedkar came from. And they were only given lower paid jobs in the spinning department, because in the weaving department, the workers had to hold a shuttle in their mouths, and the spit of the Dalits was supposed to pollute the product, you can imagine. So, Dange and Ambedkar suggested to Dange that the equality within workers should be part of the strike, and Dange refused. And so that began the great split between the Dalit movement and the communist movement, which continues till today, you know. And it's a very, very, very sad, very sad thing, because it's depleted both, I would say, in terms of just understanding, in terms of the understanding that they could have provided each other, you know. So,
what do you think in present times is the implication of this?
Well, in present times, I think that even here that communist parties, including the Maoist and Marxist parties, are largely led by Brahmins, because they are the people of the book, and so are communists. But I do think that, you know, the danger of, I've written about this in a great amount of detail in the introduction, but the danger of embracing liberalization and globalization, because it leads to urbanization and the breaking of the traditional caste-ridden Indian village, comes with a great danger. So there is a description of how caste and capitalism form a very unique ally, you know. And to not have a critique, and I don't mean just of crony capitalism, but I'm saying to not have a really structured critique of capitalism is very, very dangerous for the Dalit movement. And for the communists to not have a critique of what we call Brahminism just renders it meaningless in India, you know. I mean, I say in this essay that when Mao spoke to his guerrilla army, he said a single spark can light a prairie fire. But in India, we don't have a prairie. We have a labyrinth. We have all these firewalls, which are all based on caste, and this poor little single spark is just lost in this labyrinth, you know, coming up against firewall after firewall. So we have to come up with our own version of resistance, you know. We just can't import things from other places and expect it to work, because we have this caste system here, and unless it is the primary basis on which we understand how our society works, only the very, very privileged, only the very, very privileged can go out. I don't believe in caste, you know. And many intellectuals have, especially left intellectuals, have just made it what I call a project of unseen, you know, where the census doesn't have anything to do with caste, and people can write about identity and culture and all this without just mentioning caste at all. I mean, half a paragraph, two paragraphs, you know, that's it.
In addition of caste, Ambedkar, in fact, as you said, there is exhaustive engagement with this socialist. At some point, he says that would you assume that economic equality would bring social equality, isn't it? And that he doesn't see possible. And this obsession with economic equality, he says, doesn't apply to India, because every capitalist is running after some priest or some god all the time. So you cannot give this logic. But I would like to again come back to Gandhi, and you very nicely put how Gandhi is liked by all, from Narendra Modi to Beatles to anything. You just be everywhere, right? From alternative cultures. Now, but I think Gandhi, because you introduced this tribal question, I'm kind of hovering around the same, but the tribal question, the Adivasi question. Hind Swaraj is a very seminal kind of contribution on indigenous sovereignty, you know, indigenous sovereignty. Hind Swaraj is a text on people's freedom. It's all vacuous, what people, we don't know. But it serves well for someone who is really concerned about nature. You know, these days all environmentalists talk about Gandhi, right? So, as I said, I mean, I really find it difficult to find good things about Gandhi. But there is so much being dragged. You know, there is this environmentalist argue that Gandhi gives a picture. Right? So, is there parallel between if Gandhi is saffron, mildly, and then does this saffron can be easily converted into all these alternative ideologies of, you know, being concerned toward environmental causes and so on? How does this work here?
Actually, you know, I think though Gandhi did say some very interesting things. I mean, I don't want to, the one place where I will give Gandhi credit, and I have given him credit in this, is that he did see the seed of cataclysm in this kind of Western ideas of development, you know. He did see the destruction and the way it would strip the earth. Though he wasn't himself that much of an environmentalist or, you know, that interested in those things. But I think, Hind Swaraj, I really don't know how anyone takes it seriously, because it's just hilarious. It's a hilarious document, you know, where it just goes on about, oh, the British Parliament is a sterile woman and a prostitute, lawyers are prostitutes, doctors are prostitutes. Prostitutes, actually, I have a lot of time for, but anyway. But then there's this whole thing about how India's the greatest civilization, and no one can. Then there's also a very worrying part where he describes India as being bounded by these Hindu pilgrimage sites, you know. But then says, but you know, like in the manner of a good host, we must be nice to everybody and all that. But on the question of, on the question of Adivasis, though Ambedkar, I have critiqued him about the language that he used and the way he got. It was very similar to the language Gandhi used about Dalits, you know, very, very similar. But Gandhi was not any great admirer of them either, you know. I mean, he also called them savages. He said that Santals are the only people who are as bad as the Kafirs, which he used to call the black Africans, you know. And if you read David Hardiman's book, you see how, you know, even when there were people who, there was a big a massacre of Adivasis in the region, in the princely state of Gujarat, and Gandhi just never used to engage with anything that didn't have to do with the British. So it was just ignored, you know, the Congress, Gandhi, all of them ignored it. So, but I must say that, you know, I certainly have views on the idea of Adivasi homelands. I certainly have views, even though I am aware that an organization like the Narmada Bachao Andolan did not take cognizance of caste. But I I am a very great admirer of the argument against the Big Bang, you know. And I think it's a very profound argument and a very important argument. But how it should be fought, because I think it's the basic unit for corporate capitalism, you know, that. So, I just feel that, you know, the way we define, for example, the way we define what is oppression and what are these battles we are fighting, you know, from the perspective of women, from the, you know, NGOs cannot be dismissed. At the same time, there is a very important critique of the role for Foundation, Rockefeller, all these people have played historically, even in the anti-apartheid movement, in the civil rights movement, in Indonesia. You know, so in the, at individual moments they do good things, but what is it that they want? What is it that they are looking for, you know? We have to understand that, you know, it's not that we have to become people who cut off everybody's head, like who steps out of line, but we have to understand how the game is being played. I think it's very, very important to understand that, you know.
This NGO question, you know, because as you said, you look at multiple strategies, you know, these NGOs actually serve, given the kind of state we have and given the kind of NGOs that the state promotes, if you look at the rural cooperatives, all are state funded. These are kind of NGOs which state funds, subsidizes and so on. So these serve as sites of strategies for them. So it's not,
yeah.
So this has to be somewhere broken up and brought out so that, because otherwise it's just kind of polarized.
No, I think there are different kinds of NGOs, and you know, an NGO which is funded by Vedanta, you know, is a different matter from an NGO that is state funded or you know, yeah, actually. So you have to, but the main thing is not to become like mullahs, you know, saying, oh, this person is a sinner and this person is a saint, but we have to understand the role of the dice, you know. We have to understand the larger agendas of people, and we all can't be pure. I mean, none of us can be, you know. So that's not the point. The point is not to go around, and I think one of the greatly debilitating things that Gandhi did to Indian politics was to bring in the question of purity, you know, like, you have to eat goat curd and wear a loincloth and not have sex, and otherwise you're a bad person. So it debilitates the imagination, you know. It's that's not necessarily the only way to do politics. You know, we can also be bad people and do politics.
Last quick one, there is, in Ambedkar actually there are a variety of scholars who take him around on the class question. He appears as a socialist. At times he appears as someone who is more concerned about freedom, and by freedom he also means you know, the right of economic exercise of becoming rich, right? So he's not necessarily anti capitalist society. What he would talk about then therefore is maybe a capitalist society with possible morals of justice and welfare and so on. And given the newer way of you know, some Dalit intellectuals talking of possibilities of capitalism for Dalits, you know, Chandravan Prasad and this making of Tiki and so on. So I'm sure you also, how do you see this game of?
I mean, I see it in two ways. One is that I think it's really high time we all stop thinking that Dalits are just some homogenous mass who has to have one opinion about everything. So like everybody else, there are capitalists and communists and BSP, and that's great. I mean, I certainly am not among those who believe that the corporate neoliberal agenda is going to bring anybody any kind of equality. But within that, when you look at what is going on, I think that Dalits have more of a right to be, to at least have some capitalists and millionaires and all of that, You know, you can't just say, oh no, just wait for the communist revolution. You know, that'll amount to what the communists said to women. You know, just hang on, and after the revolution, we'll see about you. We can't have that. You know, so.
Further link to the question of caste and the morals of charity in our deepness into culture. If you also look at who is really engaged, the corporates that are engaged in giving most money, they are very few Hindu corporates actually. It's Azim Premji and the Tatas. So this
they
is
like
also
to build temples. No? I mean, there's a quote here about the villa saying we don't actually believe in all this, but we like to keep people religious, so we build these temples and so on. But yeah, I mean now it's come to a stage where you don't know. I mean, corporate capital doesn't have a country, you know. So the Tatas, the Ambanis, they are, you know, instituting chairs in Harvard and Stanford, sending out millions. The Bill Gates Fund is working here. You know, it's all. It keeps us on our toes, you know. And you have to look at things through so many multiple filters, you know. And it's not easy. It's not easy, but we have to do it.
Now I think the audience should be having some questions, so it will be over to some questions. And I want Sharmila, if you can help, unless you have want to begin with a question. He has one mic, and there's somebody can handle the other mic. And this one hand I see there.
Hi, ma'am. Just a couple of questions. Firstly, there's very little mentioned in our school textbooks on the social realities of caste discrimination. What is the manner in which you would recommend school textbooks to introduce such topics and their social realities so as to educate us better? And the second question is, considering that the BJP draws most of its electoral strength from upper caste Hindus, if a Modi-led BJP government were to come to power later this year, are there any specific or additional challenges that people from the lower caste will face either in the short term or the long term? Thank you.
First of all, one of the things that I'm trying to do is to change the language of saying upper caste and lower caste. You know, in my essay I talk of privileged caste and subordinate caste. That's very important for us to understand power, you know. The upper suddenly starts sounding as if it has some other thing. about your question about school textbooks, well, I mean, I would say the simple answer to it is that people should read Ambedkar. They really should. I mean, if they won't prescribe them in classrooms, then maybe out of classrooms. But people should read Ambedkar, you know. And one of the efforts of this book and many of us is to just try and make that possible. But I also, having said that, want to say that we mustn't turn Ambedkar into another holy cow, you know. He was a brilliant man with some brilliant arguments, some flaws, something we would like to argue about, and that would be the greatest tribute to him, you know, not to turn him into a, you know, to not to condemn him to purity in some way. The question about if the Modi-led BJP came to power, you know, a great part of my introduction has to do with the ways in which the Hindu liberals and the Hindu rights have jockeyed for this Dalit constituency right from the early 20th century or the turn of the century onwards, and you see that it still plays out today, you know, whether it's them conducting these ghar vapsi sort of ceremonies in the forest to make Adivasis return home, which is so ironic. You're trying to tell an autochthonous tribe that has lived there for centuries to return home to Hinduism, which is much newer. But I think what we will see is something which already started in the 1940s, you know, as partition loomed on the horizon, the sort of Sanskritization and the Hinduization of Dalits, which I think is something that really made Ambedkar despair, you know, because we haven't spoken about it, and I don't want to start that discussion now because it'll take a long time, but after what was called the Pune Pact, where basically Ambedkar was forced to give up his demand for a separate electorate, Gandhi started this whole temple entry movement with the Harijan Sevak Sangh at the front of it. And the Harijan Sevak Sangh was not allowed to have any Harijans in it. I mean, Harijan is an obnoxious word, but I'm just saying that was his word. But Ambedkar was so worried about this kind of false embrace, you know, pulling people in back into the temples from where the whole system of caste began. And this kind of Hinduization is happening at a tremendous pace now, both within Adivasi cultures as well as amongst Dalits, you know. So, in a way, it perpetuates caste, but makes them stay in the fold of Hinduism, in the servants' quarters, and pits people one against the other. You see, now with what we are in for is how have people traditionally held on to power by making everyone else fight, you know, and that is what is going to happen, and that has happened a lot in the Dalit movement, just pit them against each other, you know. So that is the answer to that question.
Lots of hands. Okay. I think one of your observations, this is my question is to Arundhati. One of your observations need to be checked or rather corrected factually. You refer to the textile strike of 1928, called by Mohammed Gandhi and others. See, in the demands, the charter of demands for the strike, this demand that the untouchable should be given employment in weaving department, that was mentioned there. But what is the, it is quite true that particular demand was not a priority of the charter. The other economic demands were the priority. But that demand, at the instance of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, was included. Because he also led a very, not a very big union, but he also led a small union which was a part of the strike earlier. Then subsequently so happened that Dr. Ambedkar thought that particular demand is not a priority of the strike. Then he withdrew from the strike. Not that Gandhi refused to include that demand. Sir, that is a factual fact.
I mean, the thing is that rift went on for a long time after that. It continued unto the elections later, and you know, it was a very unpleasant exchange between them.
We'll take a couple of questions and then answer. I'm just going by one from the left and one on the right. Sharmila, okay, this person with a mic there. Yeah.
Good evening, ma'am. Now, Ambedkar in speeches and even in his books has constantly told the Dalits to convert to Buddhism. Now what happens is that when people from the lower caste, they convert to another religion, the institution of caste still exists, and this has been seen in the case of Dalit Christians, and even in other religions caste has maintained its significance. So wouldn't it have been better if Ambedkar actually concentrated on bringing in internal reforms in Hinduism and giving more push to that, rather than pushing for conversion. Where, what would have been, what do you think would have been the better tool to fight against casteism?
One from the left there. Excuse me, Mike. Wait a second. There's somebody else who has been raising their hand there. Please, no, give it to him. Yeah, it's a lottery. Yeah, and there's younger right here. Depends on who he sees.
Hello, ma'am. It's more of a doubt and clarification that I would like
can
to
you
have.
Put closer to the mic.
It's more of a doubt and clarification that that I intend to have within myself. The first thing is that no, when we talk about the annihilation of caste, and that was written in 1936, and afterwards when we talk about in 2014, let's say, it's a lot of a gap that we have traveled for even for a Dalit community as well. There have been most of our political parties, they take it as a pride. As we say that Brahmins have pride for themselves, they need to have a pride for their caste. But the one thing that we talked about, the homogeneity of a Dalit, is not what we generally talk about. If you talk about the Dalit in a heterogeneity way, it's having like annihilation of caste in what way? Like if you see the hierarchy of a Dalit, what comes in the down and what comes in the upper thing. So in that sense, what do we need to understand with the context of this? Would we talk about, okay, this is what we have been oppressed, this is how the historical things have gone through. But if for a Dalit to understand, okay, I am a Dalit, and this is what I see, there is a subjugation and discrimination among the Dalit communities as well. Then where does the Ambedkar's point of argument this comes into the picture when we talk about in the present day?
On the Buddhist thing, since about this Buddhism, how caste kind of persists. I think Ambedkar's approach, there is a connection I see from 1936 to 1956, and I'm not as familiar with the Buddha and the Dhamma as a text. I find it a very difficult text to read, and I've read it in parts. And I was particularly interested, especially after listening to Ashwari Kumar's paper on the idea of vichheda. Vichhed is a kind of a traditional idea which has been debated in the Upanishads and in the Buddhist texts earlier to that. Vichheda is the concept of which comes from also shunyata and annihilation of and negation. And Ambedkar poses the question, is the Buddha negating life? And he talks about how kind of and annihilation of caste, he also uses this word living death. How for a lot of Hindus and Dalits as well, who call them, if you live with caste, it's basically you're a walking carcass as far as he is concerned. So for him it was about a rebirth. And if this rebirth involved embracing a religion which discards caste, and if you see the 22 vows of Dr. Ambedkar, he is saying, I will not, it's all about negation, I will not do this, I will not accept the Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwar, I will not accept the Brahmin, I will not. So he moves into something, but yes, the Buddhists, later day Buddhists, have been surrounded by others who practice caste. So it becomes difficult not to practice caste when everybody else around you is practicing caste. Ambedkar's call towards a renewal of Buddhism was not only for Dalits. It was not about practicing a religion in the religious sense. He thought of religion as sacred morality. Of course, Arundhati and I have a discussion about this morality business. He said morality is a difficult thing, but for him, it was a moral code that helps you not do the kind of violence you would habitually do with somebody. Not do the kind of violence the subtle violence with which Suryakant Waghmore's book opens, where somebody can, with entitlement, sit on a vehicle and then just say, where is this other guy? You know, the kind of entitlement with which that happens. So that caste persists in other religions is because these religions are surrounded by caste, if that could be an answer to the question. And to the other question, I'll leave it to you.
I won't do it, but I wanted to read one of the footnotes in my essay. See how a writer like Ismat Chughtai, a Muslim feminist progressive writer, and you should, I mean, there's a short story of hers in which she describes a sweeper, a Dalit woman, is so dismayed, you know, and yet even today it's translated proudly by feminists, and they don't. Okay, I'll read it to you. It's Gauri was her name, the feckless one, and she was dark like a glistening pan on which her roti had been fried, but which a careless cook had forgotten to clean. She had a bulbous nose, a wide jaw, and it seemed she came from a family where brushing one's teeth was a habit long forgotten. The squint in her left eye was noticeable despite the fact that her eyes were heavily cold. It was difficult to imagine how, with a squinted eye, she was able to throw darts that never failed to hit their mark. Her waist was not slim. It had thickened, rapidly increasing in diameter from all those handouts she consumed. There was nothing delicate about her feet, which reminded one of a cow's hooves, and she left a coarse smell of mustard in her wake. Now, this is a progressive Muslim woman writer, and nobody even points out, look, you just, I mean, what is this, you know, what is this, what is wrong with all of us, you know, and it's an imagination, because you know that in any case, the chances are that a laboring body is more beautiful than a body that's been sitting and eating paan in some bed, you know, but the prejudice just comes out in the most unbelievable ways, and we don't even, it doesn't even cause a blip on the ECG, you know. It's presented to us as a celebratory thing, the translation of this short story. I was just shocked. So, I mean, I myself am not a Hindu. As I said, I grew up in a Syrian Christian family, but not a very religious one. And yet, everybody around you practices caste. And when I wrote The God of Small Things, firstly, I got into trouble with the Marxist Party because it is about this tension between the Marxists and Naxal and Dalit and all that. And then I had people coming, I mean, I grew up in that village, right? Those were my friends that I was writing about, and people telling me, no, you know, you don't understand. It just can't happen. It just can't happen that a Syrian Christian woman and a Parabang can make love. It can't happen. And I was taken to court for corrupting public morality, you know, by five lawyers who basically just photocopied the last chapter, which was so offensive to them, and sent it to court. It was in court for 10 years. Every time the hearing came up, the judge would say, each time this case comes before me, I get chest pains, and postpone it. But, you know, these are the prejudices. It's not just about atrocities and killings and beatings, and it's just it's in the air we breathe, you know.
There's a question there. One second. I don't know who is it. This woman here, she is questioning it, yeah.
Mine is not a question, it is just a comment. When we are talking about annihilation of caste, I think we need to take serious note of the most profound contribution that social revolutionaries starting from Phule to Ambedkar and Shahu made about the link between caste and gender, and how gender violence is what is the most crucial factor in keeping caste alive. And I think that we have to really give a lot more importance to this aspect of their writings, and also see how we can have an organic kind of link between Dalit activists and gender activists to eliminate both these obnoxious hierarchies, caste and gender.
That's in the book actually, quite a lot about gender and caste and Ambedkar's whole engagement with the Hindu code bill, and also about Phule, and you know, yeah, it is there, you're absolutely right.
There was another person who was about to ask a question. Can I see? Yeah, there, please.
This is, I just would like to, how will conversion into another religion, particularly